Yes, it is.
Yes, this is Judge Rask. We've got you on speaker here in the courtroom. We have started with the proceeding. Your counsel's present along with the opposing party, and we're going to proceed with the hearing. So at this point, until you call as a witness, you may just remain on the phone. I would ask you to raise your right hand to be sworn.
Yes, sir, it's raised.
Okay, let's swear in this witness.
Under penalty of perjury, do you solemnly swear or affirm that the testimony you're about to give in this case should be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth?
Yes, I do.
You can please spell and state your full name for the record.
My name is John Victor Lilia.
Thank you, Ms. Lilia. Before we proceed, additionally, would you please raise your right hand to be sworn as well? You may provide testimony today.
Under penalty of perjury, do you solemnly swear or affirm that the testimony you're about to give in this case should be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth? Tell and state your full name for the record.
Daniel A. Bernath. Daniel B. Fulway. Bernath, B-E-R-N-A-T-H.
Okay, thank you. So, proceed with the way we normally proceed on matters of this nature is that the petitioner will go forward to prove they can establish the need to continue the restraining order to be implemented. At that point, the burden will then shift to the respondent to provide evidence as to why they believe the elements of the matter or other evidence as to why it shouldn't be continued. So, we'll start with Mr. Bernath. You can present, since you're testifying for yourself, do you have a witness here in the courtroom?
No.
Okay. Is your witness down the hall?
Yes, the witness is my Mr. Lilia. I have documentary evidence.
Okay. I misunderstood. I thought you had a witness. Okay. Then you may present your evidence. You both can waive opening argument or have a brief opening argument.
Well, here's my brief opening argument.
Sure, they'll both do that.
It'll sound like I'm crazy to tell you this. The hearing officer at Social Security Administration attacked me 4 years ago when I was getting on an elevator. He has been terrorizing me for the last 4 years. He contacted John Lilia and said to John Lilia, hey, look, this Dan Bernath fellow that I hate so much is speaking out that he's a chief petty officer of the United States Navy. He never was. Go get him. Now, this group is known as a suicide self-murder advocacy group of Vietnam veterans. You think I'm crazy when I'm saying this? It's an association of active duty U.S. Army, Navy, Coast Guard, and I'll give you all the evidence if you think I'm crazy, plus retired combat veterans who this judge in Montgomery County says you're a bunch of crazy veterans who haven't come down from the war. What they will do is pick a target and terrorize them to death. They have murdered 5 people so far.
Let me interrupt you, Mr. Burnett. I appreciate some background, but because of the docket... here's what I want you to do. Because you can present evidence, and we'll get to that. This is the only opening, brief opening, focused on the allegations you made in your petition. That's all we're here on today. We're not here on someone being murdered, thank goodness. We're not here on things outside the scope of the petition. I can't hear things that aren't...
Let me get right to that.
Oh, there it is. Go ahead.
So, Dan Hyatt then contacted John Lilia. John Lilia then went to his group, who said, let's make his life as miserable as hell as possible. John Lilia went to his group and said, let's shame this man, on and on and on. Thereafter, all these things happened that I spoke of, I guess, in my pre-opening statement. So what I'm going to show the court is that he clearly, Exhibit 1, made this wanted poster life as miserable as possible, and shame at me, and then all those other things occurred. So that is the crux of this petition. He is the leader. He is the person who controls them. They all communicate with through this website. So that's the beginning and end of my opening statement. Now, what I would like to do now is, could I approach the bench with the...
Sure, we have exhibits and copies for that.
He has the copies, he just gave that to you.
Okay.
500 things he complained about, pages. So this is the, I would ask the court to look at that. I give you the wrong one. Judge gets the rubber band. Mr. Lilia, you're there on the phone, aren't you?
Yes, I am.
No commentary to the party. This is your case. Put it on. You present your evidence. There'll be an opportunity if you want to call a witness. If I hear anything out of line.
First witness.
Okay, well, you're testifying first, so give me your evidence. Then we'll, when you're done testifying, we'll take another witness.
Could I take him first?
If you'd like to.
All right, Mr. Lilia, this is...
Oh, hold on a second. Go again. Okay. Yeah, I'd like to hear that.
Matters involving Judge Hyatt and Mr. Bernath, for which Mr. Bernath is criminally convicted in the U.S. District Court.
Objection, that's all.
Move on. Are not the matter on which we are here today. Mr. Lilia is an administrator of a website called The Saint Help, which is a website that pays some attention to people who they vernacular referred to as fallacy. A few months ago, Mr. Bernath created the evidence will be appropriated a photograph of a chief of the Navy, photoshopped, to use a term, his head onto this other person's image, which is a formal photograph showing his chevrons of service, chevrons of rank. Service. Mr. Bernath served a little bit less than 4 years as a photographer's mate on an aircraft carrier during the war. People in the Valor Thief community took exception to that. The evidence will be that the poster is not something that Mr. Lilian created. I think we will acknowledge that the poster appeared on this website. There are some 350,000 posts on this website, but they are not for Mr. Lilia. Evidence will also be that Mr. Lilia has never been in Oregon, has never met Mr. Bernath, has never attempted to contact Mr. Bernath other than an email he sent a few months ago asking Mr. Bernath to stop contacting him and otherwise contact me as his counsel, and that he has done nothing to harass, threaten, or intimidate Mr. Bernath. Further, as a quick point of procedure, I do not have a copy of the exhibits that Mr. Bernath marked today.
I hear interruption again. We're not going to continue. You're a lawyer. You know better. Wait.
You can show them to me in advance of the hearing, but I do not have copies, so I may ask to reference them during the course of the testimony.
That's fine. You'll work around the copy problem.
Sorry? I address those 2 points.
I'm going to present your evidence. It's an argument time.
Okay, well, I'll state under oath that I was not criminally convicted of anything. I've been a California lawyer for 30 years.
Okay, counsel, look, I want to proceed in a way that's going to make
very good
flow. You've asked to call a witness. You said you wanted to call a witness.
Well, let me do that. I'll do that right now.
That'll make it clear. That means you're not testifying yet. Mr. Lilly is. So let's go in an orderly flow. So if you want to call yourself first, fine.
No, I don't.
But if you want to call Ms. Lilia, that's fine. So let's call Ms. Lilia first then. Ms. Lilia, are you present?
Yes, I am.
Okay. The petitioner is going to inquire a few questions that are relevant, petitioner, to the petition that's been filed. And Ms. Lilia, you'll be required to answer them if I think they're appropriate legal questions to be asked. So we will proceed with the inquiry. Counsel, you may inquire this witness.
And I proceed under Oregon Rule 40.180, routine practice.
Who?
Mr. Lilia?
Me? No, I won't. You're not. So I won't. I will call you Mr. Bernath. Because I have your military records and you were never promoted to that rank?
Are you aware that the Sea Scouts have hundreds if not thousands of chief petty officers of that club?
No.
Are you aware that hundreds of yacht clubs in the United States have commodores and chief petty officers? Are you aware of that?
No.
Are you aware?
No, I did not.
Did you hear Karen Williams so testify under oath in this court in Rockville, Maryland?
Yes, I heard her. I admitted that I heard her say that, but I did not say that.
Did you say that you were going to defecate on his mother's grave?
No, I did not.
Okay, let's talk about what the court said.
I'm going to cut you off here because I still haven't heard you ask any questions that are relevant to the petition in front of us.
Okay, I'm trying to show that he acted in character with. Which was his habit of terrorizing people who they picked out as a target.
Well, I need to show that he did to you. Showing it to somebody else isn't going to cut it.
But I don't want to argue with the court, but 40.180 says I can talk about his habits.
Right, but habit requires more than one time. Habit evidence is kind of a standard that is, birds fly south in the winter, and the weather, the sun's going to rise in the morning. Habit evidence is of a certain nature. This is not habit evidence, what you're soliciting. You can't use a prior wrong to prove this wrong.
Well, okay,
you've got to prove to this court that the allegations you've made about this respondent are the type of restraining order needs to be continued.
Dallas Wittenberg, who said, I'm personally going to stop your ignorant ass. I already have your address and the means to get there. You remember sending that email to Dallas Wittinger of Florida?
You mean Dallas Wittgenfeld?
That's you pronounce it your way, I'll do it my way. Did you, in fact, send an email saying, I personally am going to stop your ignorant ass. I already have your address and the means to get there. Did you send him that email?
No.
I'm showing his pattern. I'm showing his habit.
I'm going to allow you to answer the question over the objection. Go ahead, answer the question.
Honestly, I don't remember sending it, but I may have. I'm not saying that at all.
Okay, you have ALS, correct, Lou Gehrig's disease?
Yes, I do.
Has any doctor told you that there's a mental component and a mental deficiency related to your ALS?
No.
All right, let me, then, if I ask you a question, then you can answer it then.
Sure, and that's what I've been doing, Mr. Bernath.
Okay, let me ask you this. Do you recall on February 13th, 2014, on your website, posting this. Here's your wanted poster for Daniel Bernath, who is never a chief officer, honorably or otherwise. Remember
yeah.
doing that?
Yeah, I do.
Okay, well, you're not here, so I'll read it to you.
No, you don't need to. I know what it says.
Okay, I'm asking the question.
Go ahead. No, I did not.
I need to try to cross-examine. Hold on. The question was, did he post it online? And he answered, Mr. Leal, did you in fact post it online?
Yes, I did. I'm not exactly sure how many people did, but that sounds about right. No. If it's the truth, it's not derogatory.
Okay, so we'll leave that to the court to decide if that's a derogatory statement. Extremely annoying. There are legions of people who agree with you, so I want to ask you about that. Okay. Then you have a red
line through it, and big black words it says fraud. Correct?
Yes.
Okay, now, would that be ridicule or harassment or derogatory? Would you agree with that?
Not if it's true.
Okay, so if it isn't true, then it is derogatory, correct?
Sure. But it
okay,
is.
So I'm under oath right now, and I'm going to tell you that I can create this picture.
I'm not trying to present evidence for you.
Okay, then I'll
present just the questions. Yeah.
So anyone with information on this POS, now is that a Army term or a West Virginia term? What is POS, please?
It's an internet term.
Piece of shit. Is that right?
As long as you're saying it, yes. I'm not going to talk like that in court, but go ahead.
But, okay, now, is that what that POS means?
Yes, it is. Normally.
To interface with him, does that mean to harass him? What does that mean to interface with him?
It means to make sure that you don't spread your fraud everywhere else in the world.
Well, how would they do that?
By calling you out in public. They'd say, you didn't earn those stripes that you claim you earned. You didn't wear those you didn't earn those medals that you're wearing. No.
Okay, so they would do this in public, correct?
If that's where they ran into you, yeah.
Okay. 60,000 people or so you told us to. Now, let me ask you this. Here's the next sentence. Make his life hell.
Make his... I'm sorry, what did you say?
This phrase, make his life hell. You posted that phrase about me, Daniel Allen Bernath.
Sure.
Okay, what did you mean, make his life hell? Do you mean go up to his house and knock on it, send him emails and tell him he's a fraud, go to the VFW and demand that they pull his membership, go to the Oregonian newspaper and say that he was a fraud. Go to Lars Larson TV radio show and say he's a fraud. Is that what you meant by make his life hell?
No, not necessarily. For one thing, when I went on Lars Larson's show, I didn't even mention you.
Okay, well, your co-conspirator, co-defendant, Terrence Hooley, did. Now,
I'm going to cut you off. Yeah, before counsel's ending, because there is no co-defendant in this case, so we're not trying any other elements of any other continuing litigation, just this issue.
Okay.
Any more questions about this document?
Okay, when you say make his life hell, did you mean that you caused him so much stress that he would break out in stress-induced shingles? That make his life hell? Was that part of that?
No,
part of that?
No, part of making his life hell would be like, you know, I don't know, filing frivolous lawsuits all over the country against him, you know, things like that.
Okay, so you'd abuse process, but you wouldn't cause me shingles, is that right?
No.
Okay, well, let me ask you another question. Now, I told you that my wife had heart palpitations because of this poster and what she posted. Was this making my life hell? Was that part of making my life hell to see my wife suffer?
The only time that you've communicated to me about your wife's problems was this last weekend while I was under this restraining order thing. So I didn't even read, I've read part of the email and I didn't read the rest of it. But I certainly didn't mean for anything to happen to your wife.
Okay, so there is a bright line about how you make Daniel Allen Bernath's life hell, and it stops at his wife suffering heart palpitations. Is that your testimony?
Yeah, I guess so.
I would move to enter Exhibit 1.
Any objection?
No objection.
Okay, thank you. Any further questions of this witness?
I have to take a look. Oh. Okay, now, on your website, and I'll just be 3 minutes, on your website, and in court in Montgomery County, the lawyer asks you, so if I see John Villia on this Ain't Hell website, Lilia wrote it. Isn't that correct? You said that in court and you would adopt that today?
I'm sorry, I didn't understand what you were saying.
If I see John Lilia on your website, it's John Lilia that wrote it. Yes?
Yes.
Okay, so how to be a good pony soldier, which you posted February 9th, 2014. So you said, so we're going to give you the same that you create when you put that shit on, correct?
Yeah, I said that. It wasn't said to you. It was said generally to the public. It doesn't say, Dear Daniel Bernath.
Okay, February 9th, 2014. This is, we're talking about your motivation to do what you did to me. Now, you're really unhappy with the Stolen Valor Act that was knocked down by the Supreme Court. You said, even though what you're doing is not illegal, it's not immoral. The Supreme Court, and now I want to focus on this sentence, the Supreme Court case of U.S. versus Alvarez gave us a warrant to hunt you down and bring you to the justice of public opinion.
Yes.
Is that your feelings?
Yeah, I wrote that.
And I shouldn't go to my wife because your words, it makes you look like the giant pussy you are. Those are your words?
I wasn't talking to you, was I? I made that general statement. It was not made to Daniel Bernath. No. As a matter of fact, I was thinking of somebody completely different when I wrote that line.
Is this thing still on your website even as we speak?
Yes, it is.
You're only going to be further humiliated if you do it in the public forum. That's just don't sue me, right? Remember saying that?
Yeah, I wrote that.
I sleep with a 45 by my bed. I have another 45 in my workspace. And I carry a 357 Magnum on my hip at all times.
Yeah, and to keep that statement in context, I said don't make death threats to me because I have a 45 by my bed, I have a 45 by my workspace, and I carry a 357 on my hip.
Well, okay, we'll look at those weapons in just a second. Mr.
Burnett, I'm going to stop you here for a second.
Well, could I go one more minute? This is the
sure.
Key point.
Okay, then get to the key point.
You're really angry about the Alvarez case, U.S. versus Alvarez, as you testified. I'm going to read this last statement because I told you to remove it. I said, is this still your feelings? And it's still up there. But this ain't hell, and all of our partners are the stocks and dunking chairs in the village square of the internet. A place where folks can come and throw rotten tomatoes at valor thieves. The Supreme Court gave us a warrant to be the internet's vigilantes and bounty hunters. You said that. It's still on your website, correct?
Sure.
Yeah, I just want... That's funny how you never find something you wanted. I have your exhibit 8 and 9. And this looks to be some sort of military rifle with a scope. And at the top, there's a, it looks like it could be a Glock 45 with 30 bullet magazine. This is something that I found on the internet under your name. Does this sound like a picture that you posted of your arsenal?
Objection, Your Honor. We need to identify.
I identified it as petitioner's number 8.
I'm gonna sustain the objection. I think it's too vague. You can ask him if he owns guns. He's testified about the certain guns. But just saying, asking a question about something you might have found on the internet.
Is this a picture you posted on the internet? You did mention that you have a large magazine for your pistol because it pisses people off because they think it's scary looking. Is that correct?
Your Honor, a tape objection, the witness cannot identify the photograph.
Yeah, I'm going to sustain. You can ask him if he's posted pictures on the internet of guns he owns.
Do you have a picture of guns on the internet, including one with a 30 or so bullet magazine, and you got that magazine because it makes people angry or pisses them off or something like that? Yes? No?
Yeah, the picture that I posted about 3 years ago, before I knew who Daniel Bernath was.
You didn't take him down when you started your campaign ID, though, did you?
No.
Okay, now, looking at exhibit number 10, and it is a postcard that says, Cafe Press is the place to put the stamp and the place to put the address, and it's the poster again, so... Did you take this poster and have it printed up so that people could mail it all over the country?
No.
And you know who did that?
Yes.
Who did that?
I'm waiting to see if my lawyer objects.
He isn't. Go ahead. Answer the question.
Okay. Yeah, I know who it was. It was one of my readers, Frankie. I don't. I know him by Frankie.
Frankie C. Correct.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, one of your readers, and I don't know how much time you want to spend to get into how much control he has over them.
Right.
But I'm going to read this to the court.
I'm going to catch up because here's the problem. Petitioner, you're making a strong case about what you think are defamatory statements made by
the respondent,
or statements that you think are intended to injure you.
I'm just tracking the statute, Your Honor.
I understand where you're trying to go, and I appreciate that you're doing the best you can with what you've got. But so far, I'm not hearing evidence to meet the statutory requirement. What I hear is an ongoing battle between two people about what or was not the truth about this picture. And I hear things being said that are derogatory and are disconcerting, but that's what civil defamation was. Restraining orders, statutory requirements for a restraining order for elder abuse requires something higher than what I'm hearing. So I I've read your petition, and I'm not hearing anything. I'm not seeing anything here that's different than what evidence you're presenting.
I need to give a legal point.
Yes, you need to connect the dots, because at the end of the day, clearly you have a conflict with this gentleman, and clearly you don't appreciate what he's saying about you.
Well, the price is much higher than that.
Well,
looking at the statute, it says, ORS 124.0051A, any physical injury caused. It's causing me stress, causing me shingles, painful shingles. ORS 124.0051D, willful inflicting of physical pain or injury. 124.0051E, and this is the point, you know, it could be defamation, but I don't care if you call me poo-poo head, and they do, you know, the equivalent of that. What I care about is they set loose this torrent of people to harass me. Now, and it could be defamation too, but it sure fits right into 124.0051E, using derogatory or inappropriate names, phrases, or profanity, ridicule, harassment, coercion, threat, cursing, intimidation, conduct of such a nature as to threaten significant physical or emotional harm to the elderly person. This is the crux of the case. Him turning loose 60,000 people on me around the country fits squarely within 124.0051E. I had to make that statement before I released this witness. This is going for another half hour to prove that he actually controls them. And he, a tall, muscular man in a hammer and sickle beret, Markov pistol in his hand. You can't take it anymore. You race to the rafters, affix a rope to one of them, and end your reign of terror by your own hand. Now, this is HS software, okay? He said that was the best fit into what you meant when you said make his life hell on the poster that you admit that you posted to 60,000 people.
I'm sorry, what was the question?
mind right now. So I stopped it before we got to this. But the pain was just as
great. Just want evidence of what you're saying you have. If you have a picture of yourself that you want to offer to evidence of the shingles that you say were caused by the respondent, show me that evidence.
Very good. 3, 4, 5. Shall I approach the bench or
show him first to counsel?
He's seen them.
Counsel, do you have any objection to the photos?
Objection to the photos of the foundation.
Okay. I move them to have evidence.
So I counsel's noting that the foundations, I want to hear for the record, you're telling me these are pictures of you.
Yes.
When were they taken?
April of 14th of 2014. I had medical treatment. They said, drop what you're doing. Come to the VA right now. The doctor came out. From meeting with a patient to meet with me, they examined me along with a paramedic, and they immediately gave me some sort of drug. But the drug didn't stop the pain, it only stopped the outbreak of blisters.
I'll allow the photos. So exhibits 3, 4, and 5 are. Any other evidence of petition you want to offer?
Yes. So, after the poster was made, 3/16/14, there's a knock on my door. No one was there. I saw bushes near the street moving. 3:50, this is Tigard, Oregon. I get to the door. There's no one there. No message. No delivery. It's a Sunday. I see the bush moving. 5/11/14, knock on the door. Nobody there. 5/12/1/29, heard a knock on the door. Looked out. Saw nobody. It sounded like it was on the glass, like a light knock, knock, knock. And then 5/23/1/15, I hear a loud knock at the front door. I look out, no one's there. The national VFW contacts me and says that they're going to begin a hearing to expel me. The local Tualatin VFW.
Yeah, I'll sustain.
This is unleashed hell on me, and I
understand. But evidence relevant to this, so.
Oh, this is what he did. The Oregonian calls me, writes me, says that I'm a fraud. It's going to publish tomorrow. Lilia says on the email, they said, when are you going live? And Lilia says, tomorrow, meaning. And then they said, what publication? And they said, the Oregonian. Well, I had a discussion with the Oregonian and explained to them that it wasn't true and that they paid a severe price and they didn't publish anything. So Lilia, directing the Oregonian. So, if I could just have a moment with my thoughts. Okay. And then I'll be done.
I'm still a witness, right?
You'll get your chance. Your lawyer can ask you questions a little bit.
Okay. All right.
Okay, that's all my testimony at this point.
Okay.
I do want to enter Exhibit 13. I mentioned that this is where Lilia posted the wanted poster with 60,000 people. And you can see it's been a long time for me to.
Go back to Exhibit 13, and that's the only copy we have.
Sure.
Back to the court.
never a chief petty officer, honorably or otherwise. So he said that, and that page two of that.
So this is the mark on page one. All right.
And then page two, where he posted the wanted, dead or alive, I guess, poster. It's highlighted in yellow. What is your address? make a notice motion for a protective order. I'm going to tell you where I am after you said you're going to make my life hell. And I would be targeting my wife and daughter.
Okay. I'm going to hand you what I marked the copy of Exhibit 101.
Testify that this was that this
situation is not accurate, this evidence and the contention that it is accurate. So I'm going to allow it to answer the question.
This looks to be a, I don't know. I've never seen this thing before, even though I sent you my exhibits. I don't know what's accurate or inaccurate.
And hand you what's been marked 104 and ask you if you recognize this.
Ask me what?
Do you recognize this document?
No.
You know John Shepherd?
No.
And hand you what's been marked exhibit 105 and ask you if you recognize that document.
Yes. The head, I ran for a school board in Tiger Tallis in 2005, and I had a professional photographer make a portrait of me. You see, the picture's 20 years old or so. And the rest of the picture, I have no idea what it is. But from my whiskers to the top of my bald head is a picture that a professional photographer took 20 years ago of me. Rest, I have no idea.
Do you know who made that document that's exhibit 105?
Good market. What's 105?
That's the one of the photo of your head.
Well, I know who. What?
Do you know who created that image?
I think Mark Seavey did.
Okay. Do you have any reason? Why do you believe Mark Seavey created that?
I don't know, put my head on a lieutenant commander or a captain.
You know of a website called Special Day?
Yes.
What is that website?
It's a root directory. It has many websites attached to it.
What is your affiliation with that website?
None.
Do you post on it?
No.
Do you control it?
No.
Do you know who does?
No.
Let me hand you a copy of what's marked exhibit 106. Represent to you that this is a photograph of what was appearing on the special day. When it was downloaded at my office on Monday of this week, where the identifier at the top of the webpage was Daniel Bernath. Do you know why your name would appear as the creator of this website?
No.
Do you recognize any of the content that appears on this website?
No. Well, yeah, I think...
other images that are on this page?
Absolutely not. I know nothing about Photoshop.
you know nothing about the A Special Day website?
That's right.
Did you at any time in the last 10 years operate A Special Day as a website?
Remember how the photography business called A Special Day?
Yes.
Did you operate a website for it then? That was called A Special Day?
Yes. And you were a photographer? Correct?
I was a photographer, yes.
And you were a photographer's maid in the Navy?
Yes.
And you know nothing about Photoshop?
Photoshop was invented in 2000, the year 2000 or something. I stopped being a photographer's maid.
Are you taking any medication today?
Yes.
Have you ever met John Liljang? In person. Have you ever seen him in person?
Where I looked at him and saw him.
Have you ever seen him in person?
No.
Have you ever seen him at your house in Tiger?
I believe I saw him moving the bushes, or an agent of him moving my bushes.
No, did you ever see Mr. Liljang at your house in Tiger? You saw his body, his face, you saw that. So
okay, you're going to compound question. Did I see his body? No, did I see his face? No, did I see his activities?
Yes. Your earlier testimony is you saw no one all the times that you said there was a knock on your door. Is that still your testimony?
Yes.
Are you employed?
No.
When was the last time you were employed?
The VA declared me disabled and Social Security disabled, let me think. It must have been right when Judge ALJ Hyatt attacked me, so that would be 2000, 4 years ago.
And when you say Judge Hyatt attacked you, that's the conduct that led to your criminal conviction for disorderly conduct?
No.
There was some other conduct that led to that criminal conviction?
Yes.
What conduct was that?
I walked to the elevator with this. Pointing to my case with my crutch, rehabbing that crutch. I walked in the elevator. Dan Hyatt, who's just been suspended for petting women on the standing as a judge, was already in the elevator. He ran to the front of the elevator. He yelled at me that I'm not going to get out of the elevator. I'm surrounded by people. He then chest beat me twice. I then came to this court and got a restraining order against him the next day. I then went to court because he's a federal felon.
You asked the question, and you're going beyond the scope of the question. So, any further questions?
Well, I want to ask a few more things.
What I was convicted of.
Well, you answered it wasn't related to disorderly conduct. I want to make sure.
Well, no, they called that disorderly conduct, and then I blocked the elevator that the judge was blocking while people were around me.
So you were convicted as it related to the incident with the judge.
When was the last time you were employed?
Less than 4 years ago. That's my recollection, let me think. I reactivated my bar license. And I'm looking at taking on a case against Yelp of California. So, I haven't filed that yet. So at what point I become employed again, I don't know.
What was it's so awkward to try to figure out where you're going, sir.
Ask the questions, I'll answer them, counsel.
All right. How many times have you appeared on the television show Grimm?
Oh, that's right.
Okay.
I'm going to stop. Why is this relevant to this?
I'm going to get to one further issue, and I'll withdraw the question. Thank you.
Okay.
All right, I have no further questions. I take it, unless there's some rebuttal testimony at this point, we're at the end of the case in chief.
I want to point out. Restraining order I got against Judge Hyatt. It lasted for a year. The captain's head, John Lilia, a partner of Mark Seedy, a partner of Lilia, made this Photoshop of me
hit with the captain's body. The pike, where he's...
What happened is that I testified five people they have pushed to suicide. My testimony, I'm referring to that, and they were discussing it on this same hill. And some of them said, well, F him. He got what he deserved. It's a warning. It's a warning to others. And Lillian said, we're going to leave this all up. Paraphrasing. We're going to leave all this stuff up about how we attacked this guy and hit on a pike on the way to our community. This is what John Lillian posted. As for a special day, council, maybe he did it inadvertently, misunderstand and give the court bad information. A special day is a root directory. Over the years, there have been a special day dentist, a special day law office, a special day travel. What I'm saying is that it was a special day guide was a root directory that I used at one time, and that other businesses were permitted to hang on to that and thereby bypass having to buy a whole server plan of $50 a month. They could simply be a directory off of the big directory and then have a redirect to their website. So what is going on here, this Jake Hill appears to be like the dentist, the doctor, the lawyer, who merely have websites that hang on to that. We don't have a server company, $50 a month.
Anything else to add? All right. So, petition rests?
Yes.
Okay.
At this point, I'm going to renew my motion to dismiss on the basis of jurisdiction. You've got the burden of proving that my client is subject to the jurisdiction. Further, I'll move to dismiss for two other reasons. Mr. Bernath is not 65 years old, he's 64. Did not bring this as an elderly person. He brought this claim as a disabled person. He has put on no evidence in the not to fail further, he has not put on any credible evidence that he has been harassed or abused in the context of this particular statute, Your Honors, nor has he put on any evidence to indicate that he is in imminent danger of further harassment and abuse. The court has noted clearly Mr. Lullier and some other people do not appreciate some of Mr. Bernath's conduct. Mr. Bernath does not appreciate some of Mr. Lullier and other people's conduct, but that is not what's important to this attention. Why is this important? Because, first of all, I still happen to believe that the law is important and needs to be enforced according to what it is. I also believe that this is an abuse of the restraining order process. The court can take judicial notice that in addition to the Clackamas County case where the fraudulent perjurer's declaration was filed, there's also litigation pending in Multnomah County Circuit Court, which is case 14010063, in which Mr. Bernath is prosecuting claims for intentional infliction of emotional distress. And he's using in those cases the finding of this court. This is he uses this restraining order as prima facie evidence of things that it is not. So it is important to address this and deal with it within the context of the law. He has not proven he's disabled. He has not proven he's been abused within the intention of this. He has not statute. He has not proven that he is in imminent danger of further abuse. All he has testified to is that on four occasions, on three of which Mr. Lullier was in Washington, D.C., according to the record that he makes in his memorandum in opposition to the telephone appearance, there were rattling of the bushes and he saw no one. That is the whole of the testimony. And on the strength of that testimony, the court should dismiss it at this time.
Well, he brings up the lawsuit downtown, LA. I'm a defendant in a cross-examination there. Judge Hyatt has sued me because I brought a restraining order against him 4 years ago.
I'm going to strike that reference to any evidence. Argument the counsel's made that's not been presented here so far.
Okay, now I haven't proved that I'm disabled. He asked me the question. I said yes ever since I was disabled in 14. facts. My job is to bring in the facts. I bring in the law, and you can do what you want to do, and that's why you're there and I'm here. I think that it would serve the public, it would serve me and my family to keep an order to stay where he is and never come at me again. The wanted poster, and I know you won't do that because that would be going outside the record, but you could go to Google and say, wanted Bernath. And my wanted poster, the one that's Exhibit 1, is right there for the next 60,000 people to look at and unleash hell on me. And that's what I want the restraining order to do. It's saying, stop talking about me. You can call me all the bad names you want to. They call me Bernasty Pants. I'm like, well, this is like junior high school stuff, you know? But it's telling people to make my life hell. No. Make his life miserable. And they have. Should be stopped. It's an order from you to tell them to not mention me again in the future. With put this all to rest. There's no reason that this wanted poster should stay up that John Lilia presents to 60,000 people a day, it looks like. And that's all I've got to say. Thank you, Your Honor.
Thank you. Counsel, one quick thing. Crocker and Evers, the patience, you guys. We've got Judge Butterfield will take the case at 3:30. You can have it heard today. Sorry. I've already been telling my witnesses. Have you? We're just not going to get to it. Oh. Well, okay, so we've been trying to find a judge for you. That's what we've been doing for the last couple hours. Is that way you can recover those witnesses? Is it possible to call them? Because Judge Letourneau cannot hear the matter next week. That's the problem. Well, the opportunity to start it at least today might be worth it then with Judge Butterfield if you try to continue and get on his calendar. I mean, otherwise, you may be looking for a long time to try to get on somebody's docket. I don't know if you two want to chat outside about that, let me know. But he can take it at 3:30, and when I finish this matter, we can take it up if we set a record for what we're going to do for the next steps in the case. So, all right. Thank you,
Your Honor. Your Honor, we'll take exception to the part of Mr. Bernath's narrative, which is outside the factual evidence that we presented today. The issue is still, what is the purpose of a proceeding under Chapter 124? As the court has observed in dicta, there are other forms for the rest of this junior high behavior. I understand all of that, but for purposes of respecting Chapter 124, basis of the motion is restated. He has not put on evidence that he's disabled. He has not put on evidence that he's been abused. He has not put on evidence that he's in imminent danger of abuse. And he has not proven that Mr. Lilia is subject to the jurisdiction of this court.
And
at the closing of this case in chief.
I understand. Well, I understand where we're at. Let me, I understand the start of the case. At the end of Bishop's case in chief, we turn and look at the evidence and decide what's here as to whether or not the burden that should have responded to address or counter the evidence that's presented. I have to say for the record, the actions of all parties in this case is disappointing. It's disappointing that there are issues with behavior online. You're all throwing mud back and forth about statements made and things done online. But I am bound by the statute and the evidence. And the requirement to continue the restraining order is evidence sufficient to prove the fear of a future harm. And you've got to tie that harm and the fear of that harm to the respondent. It's clear the petition may be subject to other people who are making comments. I mean, the evidence is clear. You've offered evidence about many people who may be saying derogatory things that you contest or contend are not true. I'm not here to pass judgment on them one way or the other. I'm only here to determine whether or not this respondent
responded whether the restraining order should be continued. And I do not find that the evidence meets the statutory requirement to continue the restraining order. I appreciate you're dealing with problems from people.
I appreciate that.
That you're dealing with, but
I believe that I meet the statute specifically. And I'll just take it to the next court.
Well,
we could put it to a prerogative, but I appreciate you. You've got your rights. I will dismiss this restraining order, and that'll be the finding of the court. And if you need to get your exhibits back, we can figure out that process. But
Your Honor, may the jury be excused?
Yes.
All right, John, go ahead and hang up. We'll call you shortly.
All right, thank you.
If you want to remain here.